Jesus, we love you. God, we thank you for new life in you. You are our confidence, you are our hope. So Jesus, our eyes are on you. Hear the cry of our hearts as we worship. Thank you, Jesus. And you're calling me over. You're pulling me close. With love you surround me. You give me hope. Taking me deeper, you're making me whole. With grace, you redeem me, you restore my soul. And now I'm made new.
Let the king of my heart be the shadow.
That his intentions are good. He is powerful. He is able. is the Almighty God, Lord of the host of the heavens, the God of heaven's armies, and He's good. So Jesus, we lay it all at Your feet. Place You on the throne. Rule in our hearts and lives, God. We just celebrate Your goodness this morning, that we can trust You. You're our firm foundation. No one like our God. Declare Your goodness. You're so good. Come on, just place yourself at His hands. 'Cause He's never gonna let, never gonna let you down. He's never gonna let, never gonna let you down. Never gonna let, never gonna let you down. Oh, He's never gonna let, never gonna let you down. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You, Jesus. Come on, just lift your praise to Him. Tell Him You love Him. Faithfulness through this last year, through the chaos, through the uncertainty. God, I thank You that no matter what it looks like on the surface, Your kingdom is advancing. We thank You for the privilege, God, of being a part of that. So we just surrender to You, Jesus, as we get ready to open Your word, as we get ready to take communion. remember your sacrifice. Speak to us, Jesus. Breathe life into this place. Challenge us to move from where we're at, God. Draw us close. We need you, Jesus. So have your way this morning. Have your way in this place. We give it to you. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. And all God's people said, ready to celebrate communion together. Before we do, we want to dive into God's word, so grab your Bibles, grab something to take notes with, and let's dive in. Basically want to share just kind of a devotion as we head towards communion. We've got our annual business meeting this morning, and excited about that, excited to be celebrating what God's done, who God is, who God says we are, the calling that he's placed on this place, and this maturity process that we've been talking about through looking at the Sermon on the Mount, the words of Jesus. There's some powerful stuff in there, and everything that Jesus speaks to a process, doesn't it? Anybody arrived? No? You good? You good on the process? So a huge part of the whole maturity process is owning your own journey. Okay? Owning what you are called to say yes to, what you are called to say amen to and walk into agreement with. Because it's going to be, everybody just look to your left, and then look to your right. All the humans that you see are on a different journey than you are. Now, many of us are journeying side by side with one another, but it's a unique journey to each one of us. And so the idea of owning your own journey is really kind of what we're celebrating through our annual business meeting. And so really this is going to kind of serve as the devotion heading into our annual business meeting. I'm going to talk about a few things in our next passage in Matthew chapter 6, the first four verses, if you want to turn there. We're going to take a look at that for just a moment as we get ready to take communion, all right? And coming into this, I really felt kind of this question of, you know, how, I feel this is a question that many of us ask, how should we feel about our role? You know, we talk about the kingdom advancing. You know, God is moving forward in his kingdom. He's advancing his kingdom. Light is moving into the darkness, and we have a role to play in that. And kind of one of those questions is, how do I feel about my role? What if I feel like my role isn't as cool as your role? What if my role feels smaller, less significant than your role? You know, what if I feel, especially having to do with what we've been talking about, we've been dealing with things like, you know, the question of revenge last week and forgiveness, the idea of keeping your promises, of dealing with anger, patience, right, integrity, forgiveness, some of these different things. And what if nobody knows my story? What if nobody finds out about the sacrifices that I've made? You know, those kind of questions. As we talk about this personal journey, you have your own journey. It comes with its own set of sacrifices, many of which no one will ever see. All right? And then what about your spiritual footprint? Right? What if you know, sometimes you feel like your spiritual footprint is too small. I'm not having the impact that I want to have. Anybody resonate with some of these questions? Right? How do I know, to put it in the context of our series, Yes and Amen, how do I know if my amen is enough? I want to take you over to a cheeky little passage in Romans. Paul, in Romans chapter 9, verse 20, says, "No, don't say that. Who are you, a mere human being, to argue with God? Should the thing that was created say to the one who created it, 'Why have you made me like this?' When a potter makes jars out of clay, he doesn't have a right to use the same lump of clay to make one jar for decoration and another to throw garbage into." I know you're trying to place yourself on that scale. Bottom line is, do you know what defines the value of your amen? One word. Yes. If you say yes to Jesus, you are walking out the value you were created for. That is what defines whether your spiritual footprint is big enough. Okay? We don't get to save people. We don't get to create miracles. We don't get to choose our prophecy. We don't get to choose our spiritual gifts. We don't get to choose the family we are placed in. We don't get to choose many, there's so many things about life we don't get to choose. And we don't get to choose the calling on our life, what God has created us for. So what defines our success is yes. That is what defines the value of your amen. And that's really what we're going to be celebrating this year in our annual business meeting. That's what our annual business meeting is about, is celebrating our yes. What Matanuska Assembly of God, this little church out here in rural Palmer, in rural Alaska, what have we been called to do? And celebrating those chances where we got it right and we said yes, and pledging ourselves to all those times in the future where we have the opportunity to say yes and see what God has in store. Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 4 is really kind of, there's a heartbeat that's in here that I want to draw attention to. It's kind of in between what Jesus has just talked about in all of this practical play out of being people of our word, of being people of covenant, not people of compromise, of forgiveness and not pursuing revenge, of walking out love, being salt and light. All right, and he's about to get into some, continuing this whole, what it looks like to be that salt and light, what it looks like to live out our Christianity, to live out life. And in the middle of this are these four verses, all right? And we're going to come back to these verses next week. These verses are kind of really tied into a few different key ideas, including prayer, fasting, and in this case, generosity, giving. I want to read through these four verses, and then I just want to give you a quick idea of these four verses, and then hone in on one idea that we've got to get a hold of and that we just need to rest in. Okay? Matthew chapter 6, verses 1 through 4 says, "Watch out. Don't do your good deeds." And quick note, good deeds, there's a word there, they're not sure which word is the original word there. One is almsgiving. The idea of you know, literally giving, physically giving money to the poor, meeting needs. They had a process that was technically called almsgiving. And it was this practical outplay financially of a righteous heart, okay? The other word is actually righteousness. The idea of a practical walking out of right standing with God. Things that are in line with the character of God. So depending on which one it is, it could be a setup for these next verses, or it could be tying the previous verses. All of these things that you've done, all of these sacrifices that you've made in forgiving one another, in not getting angry, in releasing things to God, in keeping your word, all these different things that Jesus has just talked about, he's talking about doing all of these acts of righteousness and the motive behind it. Okay? Watch out. Don't do your acts of righteousness, your almsgiving, your forgiving, right? Your patience publicly. To be admired. That word, to be admired, literally, the word is where we get our word theatrical. Setting up a play, putting on a performance to be noticed by people. Do not do it publicly, to be admired by others. For you will lose the reward from
your Father in heaven. Verse 2, when you give to someone in need, as you should, not if you give to someone in need, but when you give to someone in need, don't do it as the hypocrites do, blowing trumpets in the synagogues and streets to call attention to their acts of charity. Yeah, we had to get rid of the trumpets during offering time a little while ago. It's just distracting. Tell you the truth, they have received all the reward they will ever get. Verse 3, but when you give to someone in need, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. Give your gifts in private, and your Father, who sees everything, will reward you. Okay, back to verse 1. Verse 1, basically, our yes is for his attention only. That is why we do what we do. That's why we walk out our righteousness. That's why we're generous. That's why we forgive. That's why we sacrifice. That's why we reach out. That's why we let things go. That's also why we stand up for things, right? It's for whose attention? An audience of one. Ultimately, the attention from, now it doesn't mean that no one else can see it. That's not what he's saying. It's not that everything has to be private, but what's your motive? Why do we do what we do? It's for him. It's for his attention only, right? Verse 2, when it comes to praise, you may pick only one. Either God or others, right? If you want to be recognized, you've got to pick one person to be recognized, one group to be recognized by. Either God forever or others for a moment. We can pick where we want the recognition to come from. Verse 3 is, guess what? When it comes to praise, you may still pick only one. Because guess what? Guess who else praises us? We praise us. And we're really good at it. That's why it says, don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. We should be acting. How many of you guys know that we don't just count wrongs, we count rights too? Right? We make a list of everything that we have done right and pat ourselves on the back. And it's, he's speaking to this, this should be such a God focus, such a reaction to him, such a pursuit of him, such a walking in alignment with him, that we're not keeping track of these good things that we keep doing. Because that's not why we're doing them. We're not doing them for our record. We're not doing them for our satisfaction. We're doing them for the attention of one. In verse 4, you know, verse 1 was, our yes is for his attention only. But verse 4, our yes has his attention already. Sometimes we feel a little invisible, don't we? That we're just kind of going through stuff. We're doing our best, making the right decisions. We're trying to honor God. Does he see it? Does he know it? Is it ever going to be worth it? Your yes is already seen by him. Our God, what does it say in verse 4? Who sees everything will reward you. He sees you now. Reward is forever. All right? So as Jesus is moving into this place, there's a thought that I want us to get a hold of. I'm going to word it two different ways. Number one, first way is, the invaluable is often invisible. The invaluable is often invisible. You know, we often confuse press with power. Things that are well known, things that get, you know, a lot of likes on Facebook, right? If it's not posted on Facebook, did it really happen? I don't know. But the greatest realities we know often can't be seen, right? Spiritual outweighs physical. Eternal outweighs temporal. Attitude outweighs action. Right? The things that we can't see are often the heaviest in the scale. Presence must outweigh press. Check out John 15, verses 9 through 11, talking about our amen to what God has asked us to do. How does Jesus define success? How does he define what should get the press? John 15 says, I have loved you even as the Father has loved me. Remain in my love. When you obey my commandments, you remain in my love. just as I obey my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you these things so that you will be filled with my joy. Yes, your joy will overflow. What does it come down to? Yes. Does it come down to size? It doesn't come down to apparent impact. It doesn't come down to celebration of, you know, in any type of media. What does it come down to? It comes down to yes. It comes down to obedience. So that means large and influential doesn't equal amen. Do you know what else it means? Small and suffering doesn't equal amen. Some people celebrate their lack of success because it must mean that God is working. There's not an equal sign there. He may call us to that, but he also may call us to influence. He may call us to small and effective. He may call us to large and effective. What's the key in all of this? Yes. You can only judge based on our obedience. That is the only thing, by yes. Are we saying yes? Then it's okay. We are not responsible for the fruit. We are responsible for connecting to the vine. Amen? That's our responsibility. Stay connected to Jesus. Walk in obedience. He takes care of the rest. Does that make sense? And here's the thing. Yes will always produce something eternal. It will. God is constantly working on something that is eternal. But the deal is, the eternal is often what happens in secret. And here's the other way that we can say this. The invaluable is often invisible because salvation happens in secret. We're getting ready to take communion. And actually right now, maybe Pat or Robert, if anybody doesn't have their communion cup yet, maybe you didn't grab one on the end, if you could go ahead and raise your hand. We want to make sure that you have one of these. We're getting ready to take communion in just a moment. And so if you don't have one of these cups, go ahead and wave this handsome gentleman down, and he'll make sure you're set up. But I was thinking through the cross, thinking through the crucifixion of Jesus, and I was thinking through how many people were aware that it was happening. I just did some quick research, found some numbers. At the time of Jesus, there's about 300 million people on the planet. Okay? Now, you've seen the depictions of the crucifixion, and there's like, you know, two dozen extras floating around the bottom of the cross. There was quite possibly a million Jews in Jerusalem that weekend for Passover. All right, so expand your awareness of how many people could have possibly been aware of what was happening to Jesus, that he was about to die. Okay? Now let's blow that out to an optimistic number. Let's say there's a million people in Jerusalem and they 100% all were aware of what was happening to Jesus. That's still less than 0.5% of the population of the earth being aware of the greatest moment in history that was going down that weekend. Jesus dying, raising to life. Less than 0.5% of the global population was aware of something that was happening that was going to impact all of eternity. Right? The cross, the greatest sacrifice that produced the greatest benefit for the greatest number. Greatest action in all of our history, and less than 0.5% of people were aware that it was happening. And guess what? 0% of them were tracking with what was really going on. Nobody really got what God was doing. They thought God had failed. They didn't get it till that third day rolled around, then some eyes opened. They didn't get it. Nobody knew this. God was working salvation in the midst of misunderstanding, in the midst of absolute ignorance, in secret. That's where salvation often happens, in those quiet moments, those little acts of obedience that we participate in. God is working life. And we're going to have no idea what he's working until we get to heaven. Then we get to finally see the whole picture. You know, eternal life is the biggest question of value. If you want to know whether you're having an impact, you're going to have to ask the question of eternal life. But here's the deal. We don't get to make eternal life kind of decisions. We don't give people eternal life. So our greatest measure, our greatest way to know whether we are, our biggest indicator of success is obedience. Obedience to the one who can give eternal life, the one who is working eternal life. Okay? So we can't judge our value unless we're looking through the lens of eternity. And we don't get to look through the lens of eternity yet. So who do we have to trust? The God of eternity. So as we walk out our obedience, we are trusting him that every act of obedience, every time we say yes, eternity is advancing. The kingdom of God is advancing. We are having an eternal impact in the lives around us. Galatians chapter 6, verses 9 through 10. I want to encourage us with this. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. Therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone, especially to those in the family of faith. To walk out, what does it say in verse 1? That righteousness, these good deeds, to walk this out for an audience of one. Encourage you with this. Three things I want to encourage you to do, especially as we head into this next year. One, surrender your story. Allow your story to be his story. Okay? Allow his story to determine what's going on. Whether your story, to determine the value of your story, to understand whether your story is a good story or not, whether you should put the book down or not. To understand whether your story is a good story or not, you got to understand it within the context of his story and what God is writing. He is the author. Number two, release your role. You've got a part to play in that story. Release your role. Let it be his story. Let it be his strategy and how he wants to use you. And number three, count on his countenance. Know that he sees you. Work towards well done, good and faithful servant. Not the applause or the likes of man. Count on his countenance. Surrender your story. Allow it to be his story. Release your role. Let it be his strategy. Count on his countenance. Look for his smile. Does that make sense? We're getting ready to take communion this morning. So I want to go ahead and invite you. Open those cups, make all the noise you need to. Remember, there's two layers. Top layer, you get the bread, and you say a little prayer and head to the bottom layer. And actually the whole tab releases that. All right. Everybody got it okay? I don't know what your plans. Maybe we've got some that were with us when we started this journey 10 years ago. Got several families here, and I'm not sure. And families that have come in, I'm not sure what your thoughts were, your plans were, what you thought God would be up to 10 years ago today. What your 10-year plan was, I don't know. I don't know how many times we've missed it. I don't know what this church would look like if we all were perfect and saying yes every step of the way. But I do know he's brought us to this moment. And if he calls us to, I don't know what he's going to call us to. Actually, frankly, there's some possibilities he could call us to that scare me to death. There's some comfort in some other areas, some scariness in other areas. I don't know, we all have kind of our wiring and our own comfort zone. Whatever he calls us to, if he calls us to be a small community within a small community, effectively impacting the kingdom, I'm okay with that. If he calls us to grow and grow and grow and grow and grow and build a new building on this property, I'm okay with that. We got to say yes. We got to embrace what God has in store fully. Jesus fully embraced. And the greatest act in all of history, 99.6% of the population wasn't even aware it was happening. And how many of you guys know 99.6% plus 0.4% were aware something needed to happen? They were aware life needed to come. And that's where Jesus was acting. And through the lens of eternity. Don't discount small things, amen? 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Verse 23 says, "For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread, gave thanks to God for it, then he broke it in pieces and said, 'This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" And so Jesus, as we hold this bread, as we take this bread, we remember your broken body, the sacrifice that you made. Though many never saw it, many were unaware you were doing it, you were saying yes to the Father. You were walking out righteousness. You were walking out love. And I pray that we would walk in step with you, whether it is seen or not. We know, God, you see. And right now, Jesus, we just respond in worship, in gratitude, remembering what was walked out for us. The sacrifice that was made for us. And we worship you now. And we thank you that you paid for our debt. Powerful name of Jesus, we pray. Let's take the bread together. Continuing in verse 25, it says, "In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread, drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again.'" And Jesus, we thank you for the new covenant. God, that it's not by our works, it's not by our ability to be to perfectly, God, say amen every single time, to walk fully in step with you. Though that's our goal, we are imperfect. We fall short so many times. But we rest, God, confident in your love for us, in this invitation that Jesus paid the price, you have invited us in. It is now a covenant of relationship, not of regulation. So we depend on your grace. We thank you, Jesus. We worship you. We embrace this relationship as we walk it out, God, by your grace, by your spirit, by your power, God. And we celebrate, declaring it to the ends of the earth. We have life through you. We have life because you laid yours down. Thank you, Jesus. And we worship you now in this moment as we take the cup, remembering the covenant. Powerful name of Jesus. Let's take the cup. Thank you, Jesus. I invite you to stand. As we get ready to transition this morning, I just want to just keep our eyes on Jesus.
Jesus. Just take a second and just worship him. Just thank him for his is love poured out, that invitation back into relationship, that secret sacrifice of salvation. And I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're all together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me. Here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're all together lovely, all together worthy, all together wonderful to me. Jesus,
God, we worship you. We celebrate your love for us. We ask for your divine enablement to walk out those good deeds, to walk out our righteousness. And God, as we head into this time where we remember this last year, God, we celebrate your faithfulness, your goodness, Jesus. We honor you, God. As we leave this moment, God, we do not leave your presence. We honor you every step of this journey. God, with our eyes on you, God, I pray that we would wholly embrace your call on our lives. But God, that we would do it with our eyes on you. God, we would give our all for one. And I pray, God, that you would advance your kingdom through it as we surrender to you. In the powerful name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody said, amen.